Hustlers League TV, we back with another video. Blue Da Vinci got the internet on fire. He said Meech snitched, or Meech tried to snitch. He also say that he cooperated, but he didn't snitch. Now I'ma be honest, cooperating with the police don't necessarily mean that you snitch. I mean, cooperating with the police is simply, shit, giving them your name, your age, your birthday, you know what I mean? That's cooperating with the police. But to cooperate in a federal case, something a little different. It's normally called a proffer agreement. And a proffer agreement is a contract written between the prosecutor and a defendant or someone dealing with the criminal investigation. And in that contract, it states that they're willing to give helpful information. And that's what Blue did. He was willing to give them helpful information. And I know what everybody gonna say, cause y'all weirdos and y'all gonna try to dress shit up. But regardless of how we look at it, even if Blue gave them something that they already had, his lawyer said that Blue was willing to give more helpful information. Blue snitched. But did Meech? And who did Meech snitch on?
I'm Tamara Gatling. I'm making this recording in regards to my dad. He's Dion Gatling. Most people know him as Cuffy. But I wanted to make this recording so I can shed light on some facts. My dad was set up by one of his best friends, which is Demetrius Flannery, also known as Big Meech. My dad and Meech have been friends for 30 years plus. I've known Meech my whole life. I look at him like an uncle. Like, this situation has been completely devastating on so many different levels, and there's still so many questions that aren't answered. At this point, I can only shed light on what I know for sure to be facts, and hopefully one day I will have the complete truth. But in 2011, around that time, Meech reached out to my dad in regards to creating a BMF movie. So Meech hooked my dad up with a woman named Tammy Coens. At the time, Tammy was Meech's power of attorney. Also, she owned the life rights. So my dad was working with Meech, Tammy, T, basically trying to work on a movie deal. So
what Meech and Tammy did was called a third party cooperation. What happened was, originally I was put with Tammy. I paid for the script. I paid $250,000. That's my script. That's why 50 when he came in, because we put a cease and desist order in through my attorney. That's why they couldn't do a motion picture. That's why you didn't see the BMF story on the big screen. So 50 ran it through that star shit that he ran that other corny shit that he do. So what happened was, homie, was I wasn't even the original target. They wanted to get a little Mexican. He's actually a cartel member out of L.A. named Suarez. You'll see his name in the paperwork, Fidel Suarez. He was their initial target. You feel me?
Right.
He was their initial target. But with me calling in while they were trying to set up Fidel Suarez.
Not about it. You know what I mean? I didn't put your name in this paperwork. How did you get in this paperwork? These are sworn documents. These are affidavits to have you listed as my unindicted co-conspirator. These are sworn documents. These affidavits went in front for wiretaps in front of a magistrate. Under the penalty of perjury. So you think them white folks gonna put themselves in a trick bag by putting Demetrius Flannery name in there as my unindicted co-conspirator? You're my unindicted co-conspirator, man. How did you get in my paperwork? And now, there doesn't seem to be any anger or vitriol coming from your perspective about none of this.
People are having a hard time accepting and understanding. They just don't want to believe it.
He knows this, and everybody else knows this. anything with Tammy comes from him. Not only that, what she testified in court to. What Special Agent Keith Cromer fired, disgraced DEA agent Keith Cromer, who she was having a illicit sexual relationship with, which killed their case, which killed his time cut.
A St. Louis man who led a local gang and ordered two murders was sentenced Friday to 27 years in prison, the U.S. Attorney's Office said. Deion Lamont Cuffy Gallen, 53, was the leader of a gang that brought heroin, cocaine, methamphetamine, and marijuana in bulk and sold the drug in the St. Louis area from 2009 to 2014, prosecutors said. In order to retaliate against a man who cooperated with federal investigators that sent Gallen's brother, Deron Winey Gallen, to prison, Gallen ordered the murder of Theodis Howard. He was killed on the street outside of a St. Louis clinic on April 5, 2010. Gallen drove a co-defendant Andre Rush and two shooters to the scene. Rush was there to point out Howard for the shooters. Deron Gallen died of an asthma attack in prison. Gallen had Rush shoot one of the drug dealer's associates, Terrence Morgan, on May 2, 2013 in an alley in St. Louis, Fox Park neighborhood. Gallen thought Morgan's phone was tapped and that the DEA couldn't use the recordings in the court if Morgan was dead. In murdering two men who knew about the criminal acts, Mr. Gallen took aim at the very foundation of the justice system, the U.S. Attorney Jeff Jensen said in a statement announcing the sentence. Gallen was brought down by a DEA investigation that began in Atlanta with an undercover officer who arranged to supply heroin and cocaine to Gallen. Gallen thought the man was affiliated with a drug cartel. But the nearly four-year period that has passed since the indictment of Gallen and three others also revealed misconduct in the DEA's Atlanta's office. Defense lawyer repeatedly argued that evidence in the case should be tossed. They claim a DEA supervisor in Atlanta had an affair with a confidential informant who helped set up Gallen. The now former supervisor, Keith Comer, admitted that the relationship violated DEA's policy, prohibiting more than an arm's length relationship. But he denied having sex with her or falsifying reports to justify $212,000 in payments to her. Gallen pleaded guilty in February to five charges: cocaine distribution conspiracy, heroin distribution conspiracy, attempting to possess both heroin and cocaine, and possession of one or more firearms in furtherance of a drug trafficking crime with deaths involved. Andrew Alfonso Rush has pleaded guilty to drug charges and a gun charge linked to two deaths as part of a deal in which prosecutors and his lawyers have agreed to recommend 25 years in prison. Timothy Lamont Rush, another man linked to the gang, pleaded guilty to drug charges and was sentenced May 3rd to the time he've already served in prison. A fourth man, Lorenzo Gibbs, has yet to be sentenced on drug charges.
St. Louis. A federal drug agent denied in testimony here Friday that he ever slept with a confidential informer, but he admitted developing a personal relationship with her. The conduct of Keith Cromer, who was a group supervisor at the Drug Enforcement Administration office in Atlanta, is the subject of a continuing hearing on whether charges can move to trial against four alleged St. Louis drug ring members, two of them accused of murder.
St. Louis. A federal drug agent denied in testimony here Friday that he ever slept with a confidential informer, but he admitted developing a personal relationship with her. The conduct of Keith Cromer, who was a group supervisor at the Drug Enforcement Administration office in Atlanta, is the subject of a continuing hearing on whether charges can move to trial against four alleged St. Louis drug
you are
members, two of them accused of murder. Officials have acknowledged that allegations of impropriety involving Cromer and a woman known as CS1, for confidential source 1, are the subject of an internal investigation by the DEA and a criminal investigation by the Justice Department. CS1 has been paid $212,000 in DEA funds for her help with cases and played a role in providing information for a wiretap order that investigators said helped bring down the St. Louis ring. According to documents obtained by the Post-Dispatch, defense attorneys are using information provided by federal prosecutors to claim that DEA investigators may have used CS1 to vouch for improperly obtained information or even their hunches. The lawyers have questioned whether there was ever evidence to prove several of the claims that prompted a judge to approve wiretapping in the St. Louis case. Cromer told U.S. Magistrate Judge Shirley Padmore Mensah, "There's no salacious activity going on." He acknowledged turning to CS1 for comfort after his son died of leukemia in 2011, saying the DEA's employee assistance program had failed him. He said he was depressed, anxious, and had survivor's guilt, but was afraid to let anyone else know. In hiding, I chose the wrong person, he said. He said he and CS1 had been to dinner, were in the same theater to see a Three Stooges movie and had been on two vacations, but stayed in separate rooms and were never intimate. He said sometimes his brother, who was dating CS1's neighbor, had invited her along. Cromer is married, or was at the time. He denied falsifying reports to justify payments to CS1, and said no subordinates had either. There's nothing wrong with the work, he insisted. That work is solid. CS1 was paid $2,500 per month by the DEA. Cromer said that there was no written agreement but that her work was recorded each month to justify her payment. He said that the agency had the same arrangement with others and that his supervisors were aware of it. Cromer said the allegations of impropriety surfaced in May 2014. By June 2015, his security clearance had been revoked. He said DEA investigators just took it on faith that he committed misconduct. But, he said, nobody asked me about it. Twice during Friday's questioning, Cromer asserted his Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination. In one instance, the judge said he already waived it by testifying on Wednesday. Later, he invoked it when asked about his relationship with CS1 but then answered the questions anyway. Cromer has not been charged. He said Friday that he had been suspended. He suggested that CS1 made the allegations after realizing the potential consequences of her cooperation with the DEA, including possible exposure as a source. Testimony in secret. It is not known what CS1 said in court about the relationship. She testified Monday in a closed hearing. Much of this week's testimony was taken in secret, with a reporter kept out. The Post-Dispatch reported online Monday night that defense lawyers for four St. Louis suspects claimed the allegation against Cromer should result in disqualifying key evidence in the case. The four, Dion L. Gatling, Andre Alfonso Rush, Timothy Lamont Rush, and Lorenzo Gibbs, were indicted in 2014 on various federal drug-related charges. Gatling and Andre Rush have also been charged and accused of a role in two murders here. Defense allegations appear to have been somewhat weakened by what testimony was made in open court this week. A retired DEA agent, John Harvey, said some of the money paid to CS1 was for work done for him that resulted in a valuable seizure. He said agents were forbidden from even being alone with sources, much less having a personal relationship. He said that an arm's-length relationship was necessary to protect the integrity of the whole process. Harvey also testified that CS1 contacted him in 2014 about a relationship she was having and other problems with the agency, including threats she had received after being outed as a DEA source. Those threats have continued, other agents testified. DEA agents in St. Louis have buttressed information purportedly obtained from CS1, saying her reports about drug connections between Gatling and a man from California were borne out by subsequent investigation and the wiretaps. Agents here were already aware of Gatling from other investigations, they said. The proceedings recessed Friday and are due to resume November 21. $237 million to sources. A report released last month by the Justice Department Office of Inspector General said the DEA had more than 18,000 active confidential sources between October 1, 2010, and September 30, 2015, who were paid a total of $237 million. It criticized management and oversight of the confidential source program and payments. An OIG staffer has been present at times in the St. Louis courtroom, including for Cromer's testimony Friday. The prosecution's position on the claims is not clear, as many court filings in the case are sealed. Jeff Jensen, a former supervisor in the U.S. Attorney's Office here, said Friday that to prevail, the defense must prove two things: that information in an affidavit for the search warrant was false or contained a reckless disregard for the truth, and that without it there would not be probable cause for the wiretap. A DEA spokesman in Atlanta declined to comment on the status of employees named in the investigation. Ashley Listenby of the Post-Dispatch.